So, like we said, like Errol said, we talk about the Forex industry, but in fact, you know, it's a lot more than that. It's everybody wants to offer multi-assets, and everybody wants to go, you know, beyond just Forex, as we call this this panel. So we have a diversified panel of experts to talk about diversification. So now, please, yeah, start by introducing yourself.
Okay, I think my mic is on. My name is Peter Rosenstreich. I'm the head of market strategy at Swiss Corp Bank.
Hi, I'm Adam Vaziri, director of Diacor. We specialize in legal advice for digital currency businesses and fintech businesses.
Hi, my name is Justin Beeble. I work for a company called Think Liquidity. Think Liquidity is a technology provider and a risk management services company in...
Hi, my name is Malek. I'm the director for Broker Solutions Specialist Team at XOpenHub. We are a liquidity and technology provider to brokers and banks.
Good afternoon. I'm Sandy Jadeja. I'm the chief market strategist for Vibs Financial, where we provide IB solutions and a brokerage platform for retail and professional traders.
Like I said, a diversified panel of experts. So let's start at the beginning. I want you to each tell me, what do you see as you know, the biggest growth opportunity in terms of instruments for brokers right now in the industry? Please start.
I think that's a million-dollar question that we'd all like to find a solution for. You know, we've got to take a look at the internet technology. We're still in the early decades of growth. And when it comes to financial products and financial services, at the end of the day, the end user, the retail client or the professional or the institution, is looking for one of two things. They're either looking to make a profit or they're either looking to hedge the risk that their client is taking. And that's always going to be here. We're always going to be looking for evolving products and solutions. But I think in order to answer the question, sometimes I like to take a look at alternative industries to see what they're doing. And one of the industries which is always ahead of its curve is the technology industry. And the one thing that's really evolving right now is something which most people haven't even heard of, is decision engineering. Basically what that means is it helps the end user or the client make intelligent decisions as to what to do next. And we've seen that happen in the smartphone technology. We've seen that happen in mobile technology in such a big way. And that is slowly occurring in the financial market. So I think that's going to be a new growth stage. It's still early days. But when you start finding clients looking at the market and finding assisting tools where it can help them make intelligent decisions, that's going to be a key tool to have as part of your arsenal.
As in AIs, are you referring to?
AIs have been around for a while. I spend the vast majority of my time doing research on analysis, which basically is forward thinking. So we're able to find very specific dates where there's going to be an increase in volatility. So what that does, it helps us as a broker to really hone in on risk analysis to say, okay, if that's happening, then what do we do at that particular stage there? But I think from the end user, because we always want to look at providing something for that end user, what it does is it helps them to say, do I stand aside during this particular phase here, or do I go in on using specific types of products, whether it's going to be an option, whether it's going to be an ETF, or whether it's going to be a CFD, which we'll talk about.
Malek, what instruments do you see as potential?
In our view, basically, as a technology company, we spend most of our efforts trying to get technologies out to our partners, which is more or less based around the demand that they have. So what we have found over the years is that they're looking for a one-stop solution, especially on the client side. What they're looking for is something that can add value to their business. So overall, the demand for single equities as a CFD product, as an ETF, is rising quite dramatically. We're also seeing a huge demand in social trading as well. A lot of clients that you see on the end client user are looking for somewhat an idea, a direction, and which is not readily available, to my view, out there. So you've got to have specialist technologies to be able to do that. So he's quite right when he says that there's got to be some kind of decision-making process in place. We're definitely looking into something like that. But at the moment, our clients are looking for more products. They're looking for a little bit more of a direction. and we're exploring that side of the industry a lot more now.
And when you say single, you know, single stock CFDs, is that more brand based? Like somebody, you know, people are asking for Twitter, or is that like generally just give me stocks? How does it work?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, the prime example right now in this current day and time was the Ferrari IPO. So prior to that being released, we had millions of people asking for it. So this is coming directly from our clients and their clients. So it's right when you try and get the product out there, you need to make sure that there are some very complex setups behind that as well. So we need to ensure that we're able to provide that product and also provide the full infrastructure that goes with it.
Yeah, so I think on the technology side, it's platforms that are able to combine DMA access to exchange traded products and combine that with the OTC product suite. There are just some products out there that don't lend themselves to the OTC market. You know, the actual idea of trading equities as CFDs can be very capital intensive. So platforms that are able to pass through straight to the exchange, I think will be an interesting space to watch.
Hi. I'd like to just ask the audience, which currency do you think in 2015 was the best performing one? Any ideas? Any suggestions?
I know the answer.
Was it the US dollar? No. Was it the euro? No. Somali shilling, maybe.
Was it Bitcoin?
Unfortunately, it was Bitcoin. Unfortunately, it was Bitcoin. Who in the audience does not know what Bitcoin is? Perfect. So we're in the Forex industry. Bitcoin is a currency. It's also technology. It is a currency. I emphasize currency. Bloomberg categorizes it as a currency and has been, you know, rating currencies, including Bitcoin, for the past 2 years. Let me just clarify. In 2014, Bitcoin was the worst performing currency. So you were talking about massive volatility in Bitcoin. It goes from worst to best in 2 years. So what surprises me is I've looked at the Forex industry and have been in this for a while now. I don't see the industry embracing it wholeheartedly. I see the occasional CFD, maybe, plus 500 and a few others. But this isn't really taking it seriously. The best performing currency deserves to be taken a little bit more seriously. And on its heels are other technologies which are similar, such as Ethereum, Ripple. These are other technologies that have their own native currency. If I was a Forex broker, I would be looking to the future. I would be looking at these currencies and I'll be designing products around them. I wouldn't just be doing CFDs. I'd be looking at taking deposits in those digital currencies. Why? Because digital currencies have native benefits to them. They are a currency and a payment system at the same time. You might as well leverage those benefits. No processing fees, no merchant card processing fees. You receive digital currency, $100, 100 equals $100. No chargeback risk. So there are native advantages to embracing all of the technology. That's the first thing that I would say. The second thing I would say is Uberization of finance. Who took Uber when they arrived at IFX? Anyone take Uber on a regular basis to move around? No one takes Uber, no one uses Uber. Do we all just use Hong Kong taxis? That's good. No, that guy's being honest. Okay, so Uber is taking over the world and disrupting the world of taxis. Uberization of finance is happening. And banking is taking it extremely seriously. The technology that basically created Bitcoin is now being used by 44 banks and billions of dollars are set to go into this industry. So it surprises me that the Forex industry are not embracing the Uberization of finance. There should be products out there where I don't even need to know about option. I don't even need to know about futures. I don't care about those products. I just want to take out my iPhone app and switch it on and it trades for me. We need to create a better user experience for the average Joe so that you can increase your user base, but also do not discount digital currency because it will be at your own demise.
I'm not sure I could top that. That was pretty explosive. Bitcoin and our own demise. I think there's a lot of reasons why FX has not embraced Bitcoin. I think from a trading standpoint, you know, hedging it or back-to-back trading it becomes very risky. So when you actually take a Bitcoin trade and then you have to back-to-back it into the marketplace, I think there's some risk there that a lot of brokers or traders or market makers don't really want to take. So I think it's still functioning. I think it's interesting, but I think there are some real concerns about, you know, being left holding a bag and having nothing else underneath it. But I think that's this panel. So from my perspective, in terms of what the evolution, at least on a trading standpoint, I think looking at the equity markets is a very good idea of providing a realistic path for our own market without getting too far in advance with spaceships and all sorts of other things. And I think one thing that the equity market showed us is dark pools and anonymous trading, real anonymous trading. I think there's an enormous concern when I speak to clients about the other side of the market and seeing their trades and actively trading against them and knowing full well that the neutrality of the technology provider, the liquidity provider, the brokers is not really there. So I think the people that can set up a truly dark pool, a truly anonymous background in which traders can execute, I think we'll get a very good kick in terms of a strategic advantage in a very commoditized-like business right now. So the first thing I would say is a evolution to dark pools. Number two is I think we see a movement following the smart beta evolution in ETFs. So the idea of people not choosing a particular asset to trade, but trading more on a model or a strategy. So they would come in and say, okay, I have an idea for, you know, whether it's a quantitative algorithmic stat arb strategy or a fundamental-based strategy, rather than saying, I need the underlying asset. So in that strategy, you could have, you know, you could have equities, you could have FX, you could have futures, all put into a single basket structure product, you name it, whatever kind of wrapper you want. And the client trades that rather than a single asset. I think the risk of choosing a single asset and saying, okay, I'm going to speculate that euro dollar is going up, I think has faded in appeal in a lot of people's minds. It's extremely difficult. They may understand the fundamental and even technical rationale for a movement, but the idea of getting behind a single asset and nailing it is extremely difficult. So I think there's more and more movement to wrapping up trades and getting all of the pieces, getting interest rates, FX, equities, futures into a single mindset and trading strategy is one that more and more clients like the idea of.
As a retail trader, what would, you know, participation in a dark pool would mean to me?
Well, it means that you're basically protected so that we haven't, or I shouldn't say we, but the execution venue has not analyzed your flow to death, so they know exactly what kind of trader you are, if you're a good trader, you're a bad trader, you know, and knowing that your trade can honestly be executed within the marketplace without different procedural changes. I think that's what we're discussing, you know. So right now when someone executes, their profile's going with their trade, and it handicaps them in a lot of ways. So I think a black pool would open up the door, first in, first out. You know, no background checks, no, you know, just pure anonymous execution.
Well, next question I wanted to touch upon. I have a feeling Adam's answer would be the strongest, but how do you create a product that's truly innovative in a sense that it can help your brand? It can say, you know, I'm offering this, so I'm offering you a lot from, you know, the rest of the guys who offer just CFDs and Forex.
I think one of the ways, it comes down to obviously marketing, it comes down to showcasing. There has to be a viral factor. You know, today, in especially in Asia, you look around how many people are using mobile technology to communicate. So if you have a product which is innovative, which is going to be helpful to that client, then word will spread very quickly. So you have to find a way where the viral factor comes in, the news is going to spread. You can, on the opposite side, spend $1 trillion on marketing, saying that our product is the best. I mean, what is the best? Is it Samsung or is it Apple? You know, there's two types of users. You go around the world and there are nations which drink coffee, there are nations which drink tea. And it comes down to individual preference. So ultimately what's going to happen is that you have, the markets themselves in a way are quite simple. They open, they close, they make a high and a low. But from simplicity arrives complexity. And now you've got situations where you can say, well, actually, we have a tool, and this tool actually analyzes you as an individual. It tells you what your best trades have been. It tells you what the best times that you've traded. It tells you your worst situations that you've been in, the best markets that you're trading. That technology actually exists. And if I was a company, would I want to put that in the hands of my client? Not necessarily true. So it comes down to a fine line of what tools do we have that we can safely give to our clients, and how do we market that? And I think the marketing aspect, as I said, will come down to the virality factor, where the clients themselves will promote that tool.
So just to follow up on that shortly, so how long do you think until, you know, Siri or Google now is going to tell me, oh, there's a, you know, a martingale cross or whatever, you know, RSA cross, you know, there's a trigger that I know you follow, you should go into the market right now?
Google is a dangerous beast. How much information they have and they collect as to what that individual user does. The question is, how do you monetize it? And when you've got the likes of Google or Facebook, when they have that usability data, it's a question of whether they want to release that at this stage. I think it's a tool that we require. But ultimately, I've seen this myself over the last 3 decades, that you can put a fantastic tool, a fantastic charting package, a fantastic execution platform in the hand of a client. Psychology just gets in the way. You know, there is that element of, I know this system has been 93% profitable, but right now, I don't think it will work, and they just don't push the button, which creates that robotic technology, you know, the AI systems as well. So again, it really is going to come down to the user interface, the friendliness of that user interface, and then spreading it through a viral social network.
Ali, please.
Yeah, quite right. But I think something that a lot of people tend to ignore is the education side of things. Education is very important. You can create a product. You can throw it out to the market. You can advertise it everywhere. You can get the brand name out there. It's quite easy to do that these days with digital marketing. But the problem we see from most of our client base is that the education is just not there amongst their traders. And the people who are spending time and effort trying to get their traders understanding a product is fairly low, actually, to be honest. I don't see many people spending that much time doing it. I think it's a key factor. Anything you want to do out there in the market, you got to make sure that people know about it. Yeah, you're quite right about Bitcoins, that everyone knows about it, but I've never traded it because I don't know about it. So it's more or less about how you present the product to your client. In terms of the technology side of things, we see that I've seen platforms that look like Apollo 13's control panel, which is completely useless to me because I don't know what it does. So we've spent most of our efforts at XOpen Hub, for example, is to create platforms which are very simple to use. They're intuitive, so you can play around with it. It's more or less following the Apple strategy. Everyone seems to know how to use an Apple phone. But when I see a Samsung, I get a little bit confused, and that's for some reason I've never bought one. So it's education. It is missing, and it needs to be really be reiterated between the clients.
It's interesting you mentioned education, because just off the top of my head, I've seen there's a VR, there's a VR pod right now in the I think it's Tech Financials pod, and it's amazing roller coaster rides and stuff like that. But you know, I can imagine sitting in a classroom and learning about, you know, trading in an experience that's very different than watching a webinar, like actually being in a class, you know, which I think, you know, production cost shouldn't be that much higher than, you know, producing one class. So, you know, just a thought.
Well, you know, I had a go at that thing. It's quite fun. So everyone should have a go at that.
Yeah, that's a good point about the education side of things. That's probably the biggest hurdle when it comes to making an options product scalable. It's one of the issues that we ran into at some of the other brokers that I worked for. So I think if you are able to boil down what really makes a good retail trading product, it's going to come down to low costs, you know, in terms of margin, in terms of spread, in terms of the capital required for the broker. It's got to be easy to use. Tends to be short term in nature. You know, you can't have a product that takes weeks and months to unfold. And it needs to be simple, really. And so when we start thinking about at Think Liquidity, some of the products that we can actually create for the retail trader, it has to have those elements to it. So we've spent some time thinking, how do we take a complicated product like options and make it simple, make it easy, make it low cost? And that's something that we're working actively on right now, and look forward to seeing where it goes.
Before I bang on about digital currency again, I'll just take a little hiatus. I don't know if you guys know a product called Nutmeg. Have it? Is it? Yeah. Maybe it's quite common. But Nutmeg is a fintech business based in the UK. What they're trying to do is disrupt investment management. So most people realize that they're losing money by just having cash in the bank, and they need to do something with it. And in most developed countries, including Hong Kong, people just buy property. That's the first thing that they do. That's the way that they secure their wealth. But investment management is the next stage, yeah? It's, I give you some money, you go and make money with that money. But most people, to get involved in hedge funds and all of that, there's a very high barrier, okay? But what Nutmeg have done, they've reduced that barrier by using technology. So now, through your phone, you can make a deposit. You deposit, say, £10,000, and then you just simply pick an equity strategy, you know, high risk, low risk, medium risk, whatever, and it does everything in the background for you. Now, I haven't seen that for Forex. Maybe I'm wrong, but I haven't seen a consumer-friendly iPhone app where I deposit funds and I just pick a risk portfolio and it trades in the background while I'm sleeping as an individual consumer. I'm not talking about as a seasoned trader that knows the difference between an option and a spread and a bid and an ask. I'm talking about the average consumer. So maybe there is room to differentiate yourself in the market by thinking as Google would think, as Silicon Valley startup would think, building a phone for the consumer, building a phone app for the average consumer. So that's why I would say slight change in positioning, marketing positioning. Now, probably what I've said is gobbledygook. Maybe it has absolutely no relevance, and he's going to displace everything I'm saying. But that's all good. But the second thing I would say is, if you're getting involved in digital currency, it's true. How can you as a trader offset the risk into the digital currency markets? And we came back to the notion of education. Well, you need to educate yourself on the digital currency markets. This market is becoming more and more sophisticated as we move forwards. There's now ETFs on digital currency. We've got licensed exchanges in New York and other places in the world for digital currency. The market is becoming more and more established. So hedging a risk on a trade or acting as principal is not that difficult today. It was maybe a year ago if you're trying to offset your risk with someone on local bitcoins, but now the whole environment has changed. So I would say your involvement in digital currency and the opportunity that presents in differentiating yourself amongst other brokers requires you to be educated on what it is and what that ecosystem looks like. And more importantly, your consumers. Now, there's a whole massive investment in FX education, you know, contracting people to educate your potential customer base. Well, if you're going to introduce a new product like that that's exciting that your customers can engage with, well, you need to invest in the education portion for them too, so they don't just pick up the keys for a Ferrari and smash into the next, you know, lay-by. That's all I would say, my point of view.
I agree. First of all, I love Bitcoin. I think blockchain technology is fantastic. My only comment before was that we had looked at, as a bank, the idea of a Bitcoin execution. We found it very complicated, and some of the delays from when we took the trade to when we executed was a little bit scary. That was my point. It wasn't that I don't support it or I'm one of these weird doubters or things like that, but that was only it. So your analogy with Uber and Nutmeg, I think, are smack on. I think that there is a real push to revolutionize all of it. In terms of new products, a guy from the CME years ago said, Peter, if you want to build a new product, there has to be a real need. That's the most important thing. You can't just make something up and try and sell it. Nobody will buy it. It's ridiculous. So, you know, if it needs a real underlying business, you know, rationale in order for it to be successful, whether it's futures on stocks, whether it's ETF, whether it's op, there has to be a real need for it. So that's the first thing. In terms of building products, you know, again, going back, we have just built a new product based on thematic trading, which is a tool that allows us to build portfolios around ideas. And I think this is something that's, it's quite interesting, and one that's gaining a significant traction. But it's not, again, limited to FX or equities. It's a collaboration of everything. So when we look at Brazil, we look at the real, we look at interest rates, we look at lumber futures, and we put that into a basket. And that, to us, that's innovation. It's going with an idea, a thematic idea, and building a product around that that makes sense to the consumer. The final thing I'll say is that this idea of education, I think, is one that's, you know, I think there's an enormous amount of information out there. Getting more information out there, it may not be a key strategy. You know, if you want to educate yourself on Forex, you know, God, it's just almost unlimited. And I would also say that what we've seen in the last few years is an enormous evolution from not knowing much about bid offer, you know, euro dollar versus dollar yen, to guys that are writing code and IDEs in Python, wanting to get tick data in order to backtest, doing high-level quantitative analysis. I mean, it's extremely complex. And so the striation of FX or investments has in the last 10 years, has gone from, boy, do I buy a stock, do I buy FX, to I'm building my own algorithmic models where MT4 and Expert Advisor is driving our business. And these guys aren't wondering, you know, how to trade euro dollar. They're writing code, you know. So I think this market's a lot more sophisticated than many people give it credit for. And I think that needs to be sort of examined and understood.
I see. Okay, the next topic I want to hear all your thoughts about is challenges in implementing, you know, diversified strategy, whether it's implementation or liquidity or education. And I want to start with Adam, just because we already touched on it. I want to get it out of the way. You know, right now, you know, the volume in Bitcoin, which is the number one cryptocurrency, is, you know, around $50 million a day. Compare that with FX, which is $5 trillion, and let's say a large proportion of that is the euro dollar, right? So you have endless liquidity. You don't need to worry about it. And you can find, you know, plenty of people, you know, to provide you with liquidity, hedging, whatever you need. So what are the challenges right now? If, you know, I have an exchange, I want to be innovative, I want to add cryptocurrencies, what are my challenges?
Well, if you're doing a CFD or derivative and stuff like that, well, then you of course, you need to be offsetting your risk as a principal. And as I said, the market is very different to what it was a year back. Now, you don't need to be dealing with, for example, a Russian exchange that you don't even know who the owners are, and that's totally unlicensed. You can now engage with fully licensed entities. Now, absorbing the liquidity, of course, you're comparing a $1 trillion global market with a new technology that's only had 6 years to exist, 6-7 years. So, you know, the liquidity may be a problem or pose a problem, but in terms of hedging a risk, there are products out there. There are futures on Bitcoin, for instance, now. You know, there's a company in the UK licensed by the FCA that does futures on Bitcoin. So there are ways of you to hedge your risk in those markets. That's the first thing. Second thing, so CFDs does not imply that you're actually touching the technology, right? Because people deposit in US dollars, they exit in US dollars, and, you know, whatever, it could be anything. You know what I mean? It could be a bag of crisps that you're doing a CFD on. But where the challenge will be is actually integrating the technology. And I think that's where the opportunity lies. I think it would be a mistake to take a long-term vision on digital currency and only do CFDs. The opportunity lies in the education, going through that hurdle of understanding what on earth this technology is and how it may reshape the future for currency and FX, and then going through this process of adopting the currency within the platform, so taking deposits in Bitcoin. Now, if you don't understand Bitcoin, you're not going to go from that to, you know, to taking deposits. You're, of course, going to go through a third-party intermediary, make sure that they're licensed to do so, and place some of the risk with them. So I would say, yeah, there are challenges, but the market is far more sophisticated than it was a year back. So you can find the partners, et cetera, to mitigate those risks and increase your level of education, and then at a certain stage, you'll be able to take it on yourself.
And Sandy, what challenges do you see in diversification?
Diversification is a complex area, but, I mean, first of all, of course, you need a market for the product that you want to create. That has to be there. There has to be a buyer and a seller. But the other important factor, which, you know, some people can overlook, is standardization. I'll give you an example. For years, a standardization on a contract for one pip or one point would be $10 or $50 on some of the US products. And just over 19, 20 years ago, a new product was introduced into the UK, and it was something called spread betting. And basically what that allowed was that you could actually dictate how much you want that point to be, whether it's 1 cent, $1, or $10. Now, if you create a product based on that, and you have a client that comes in that is consistently trading $1 every single time, how do you hedge that when the standardization contract is $10? That can actually put the company at a huge risk when at any specific point in time, a lot of people are coming in and trading variable trade sizes. So creating a new product for the financial industry, there are not just one, but there are multiple levels of risks that needs to be assessed. Accessibility, standardization, a clear market for it. So I think, again, you know, we kind of go back to education, getting people to understand it, making sure they don't take silly risks with the product that they're taking in their hand as well. The ease of use, the ease of accessibility through mobile technology. So it's a learning curve. Every company out there is creating new products, and they're always learning by interacting with the user. What is it that you like? What is it that you don't like? And this industry, especially, we're going through that phase where we're learning from the clients more than anything else as to what you actually want.
Peter, you had to?
Yeah, I just wanted to jump in and just say, I think one of the biggest challenges is sort of industry self-made, if you will. We've created a market where someone could trade euro dollar instantly on 10, 5, you know, a million, and it's easy, it's effortless. So there's a perception that many other markets are like this. And when you start developing other products, you don't have the liquidity, you don't have the execution, you don't have the transparency. And the client sort of is a little bewildered by this, by how come they can't do 50 million in Bitcoin, you know, in one thing, you know, why does it take half an hour to find out if the deal goes through? So I think a lot of the complexity is going back and explaining, listen, this is how markets really are made. It's not this sort of, you know, endless liquidity, ease of execution. Most markets, there's choppiness. And I think that's the most challenging thing is to say, okay, listen, you want this structured product? It's going to take 2 days to price it. And the client will come back and say, well, what are you talking about? You know, I can do 50 million on euro dollar in a clip. Well, that's not the rest of the world. That's not how everything executes. So I think our biggest challenge is re-educating and the people to understand how really markets work.
And Malik, your thoughts?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, as a technology provider, what any partner comes to me and asks for a product, the first thing I normally look at is how standard is this product? Where can I go and get liquidity for it? How stable are the feeds that we're providing to our clients? And when executed, what will actually happen? Is it going to slip because of liquidity issues, etc.? And at no point I will ever put my client at risk with an instrument that is not standard. For us, it's absolute fundamental for us to have instruments that are known, readily available, and my client will never find himself in trouble, because at the end of the day, we face our clients, and we have to always ensure that the product that we offer doesn't put us at risk at the same time as well. So yes, it's fine to have structured products, but there's got to be enough liquidity available for it. And generally, you find exchanges that are reputable will have a very good standard specifications of what they're offering you. Looking at Bitcoins or looking at spread betting, for that matter, it's something that needs to be internalized quite a bit before you can actually throw that out to the market. So that time that you are sitting on the product and you're not sending it to the market, you are potentially at huge risk for yourselves.
Justin?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought up that stat about the volume of Bitcoin compared to the rest of the FX market, because that's exactly why it's not being offered as a retail tradable product right now by these FX platforms. But I took your question almost from a broker's point of view, offering retail trading products, and going through the effort of actually adding the product to the front end is kind of the easy part. The difficult part is building all the operational processes internally to actually support it. And that's what we've kind of run into when it comes to adding a new product, is not only is there an external facing education component, but there's the internal education. So you have to get a sales force that can actually talk about it meaningfully. You have to get an operations department that understands how to care and feed a new product like that. And then you have to be able to communicate it to the client.
I'm guessing regulations as well. You probably need different type of licenses in different markets to offer structured products compared with FX.
Yeah, that's a really good point. So, finding a product that fits within that context is kind of the holy grail, right? Who can do all those things and still have a product that somebody wants to trade?
Peter or Adam,
I agree. I mean, but other than a few instruments out there, having the type of liquidity that we're conditioned to in, say, euro dollar is, it's a unicorn. It's a fallacy. I mean, you look at the S&P and you look at, what's being traded on the fringes, and liquidity is a real issue. Execution's a real issue. I mean, there's very few things that have liquidity of FX. And I think if you just sit around and say, well, we're only going to trade something that we can instantly back-to-back, we're going to take no risk, you're not going to innovate. There's no room for innovation there. You're just going to be stuck trading euro-dollar. And I will say that you're going to get squeezed because the spreads on euro-dollar are non-existent. So how are you going to make a living when you're only trading euro-dollar, dollar-yen, sterling? I mean, you have to look in other places. You have to take a little risk. And, that's the nature of this business.
Also, just like to add, although there may not be the liquidity in, say, digital currency like Bitcoin, if you compare it to normal FX markets, margins are much, much higher. So the commission that you would expect to charge for Bitcoin transactions, you know, is astronomical if you compare it to just general FX markets. So I think, well, you know, there's a trade-off. You know, maybe it slows things down operationally and adds operational risk, but maybe the margins are much higher. It might become your profit engine within your business. I mean, it's speculative. I haven't done the business analysis from a broker's point of view, but I think there may be a margin opportunity in these emerging markets.
I've actually talked to a interviewed here a Korean futures broker that created a binary option Bitcoin company specifically in Hong Kong in order to you know, to facilitate that type of trade, and they say there's a huge pending demand and pent up demand, and but the thing is they decided to go with a, you know, specific an offshoot that deals only in Bitcoin because they want to have both the deposits and the trading on the same system, so there will be no exposure to risk on their side.
Yeah, you know? Yeah, that's exactly what I recommend to clients. I never say, oh, you know, you're licensed by the FCA, you know, you've got 20 years trading history, and you've got, you know, clean book, you know, take on Bitcoin. No, because that will, there's going to be some contamination. It's usually due to ignorance, but you don't want to create that risk exposure. So always create an SPV, which can sit alongside your operations, which you can use for, you know, Bitcoin and stuff like that. So. And then you start the engagement through that new entity that you created. And that what you're talking about is what we structure for clients all the time. You know, FX guy comes to us, says we want to set up something in Bitcoin. I don't say, oh, right, well, just tell SISIC and everything's fine. No, you create an SPV, new team potentially to focus on that area and build a product around that. And you leverage what you already have. So you've got that connection with the FX markets, all that know-how and all the rest of it. Those connections, you use it when needed.
We've got to take a look at another factor here. We're talking about creating new products. We're talking about creating something where people can actually participate in. To date, right now, the Shanghai index has lost 1.8 trillion, Mumbai 2 trillion, and Russia 2.2 trillion. What does that create? It creates an environment of uncertainty and of fear. Timing is critical. You can create products any day of the year, but if you've got an audience which feeling uncomfortable, unsafe, no matter how good that product is, if the sentiment is weak, they will just not trade in that environment. So it's really critical that it's not just the product, it's or the tool, it's actually the market. What sort of level of certainty and uncertainty does it create? And right now, you can go across the room, you can go across the world. People feel pessimistic about stocks. They're feeling like, okay, 2016 is going to be a challenging year. Should I trade Forex? Maybe should I trade commodities? So you have these huge cyclical factors where people have migrated. Ever since the last 30 years that I've traded, I've seen people go from commodities into stocks, into trading FX, which has, you know, obviously been around for the last decade or so. There's always going to be a new market for something. It's always going to be challenging there. But what we really need to find out is what is the overall sentiment across the world? What do people actually want to trade? They actually want to trade something without the mass volatility, something with a decent trend, usually to the upside. And so I think those are key basic factors, simplistic factors that we also need to integrate in anything that we're creating in this industry.
So you wouldn't go with an Asian ETF campaign right now?
Asia's an interesting market. My partner and I have been spending the last few years in Asia. And practically everywhere we went, and we, you know, when the question comes about funds, can you guarantee 5 to 8% per month? You know, that's a typical question that we're getting in Asia. Whereas if you go in the UK or Europe or in the US, can you guarantee 2 to 4% above base rate safely? Markets are different across the channels. The appetite for risk is obviously much higher in Asia. Would I want to take the risk on a new product in Asia with no liquidity, with a weak technology? Absolutely not. No chance at all.
And, you know, one product that I didn't see anyone here mention is binary options, which, you know, they see themselves as, you know, as part of the Forex industry. They're they're starting to offer simplified Forex platforms. What do you think about coming from the other side, like Forex taking in more binary option elements?
I did a survey early last year with a client base that I see on a regular basis, and I asked the same question. Why do you not look at binaries as a feasible product to make money? And the most common answer that I got, it's a game. So they look at it as a gaming tool. You know, and the other factor is, every time I try binary, I just lose. So this is just user feedback coming in. So what's the difference between trading a futures contract on crude oil versus a stock? Well, at least I can hold it longer. So you see the clear difference is that timing, where you're making a very short snap decision of what's going to happen in the next 10 to 60 seconds versus building hope into it that if I get it wrong, it'll come back. So there's two elements. It's looked as a gaming tool, and the fact that most people are saying that they actually just lose on a very short-term basis.
Can I just add to that? Just a question. But do you not think that the success of that particular industry is due to the usability factor? If you tell me, oh, I'm going to trade a future on oil, I've got no idea of the fundamentals behind that or what is an average price or whatever. But binary, it's like anyone can do it. I can put a monkey and do binaries. Do you know what I mean?
Disagree.
So do you think the usability factor, even though they're losing, house always wins, the usability factor will keep them ahead?
I disagree with one element of that. Not any monkey can do that, because the number one question I get from people is, it's a binary bet, what is it, how does it work? And you can explain it in 60 seconds or less, and they still sit there confused. It's a lot of it comes with upbringing. People have been brought up to invest for the long term, buy something, hold it. And what happens with binary, because it's just so short term, their brain just doesn't click. But the sophisticated investors, I still think it's a fantastic tool. I really do. But it's getting, again, comes down to education, getting the knowledge out there, but also getting them to feel safe using that tool as well.
But do you think, realistically, that the average person using binary options finds it more difficult to use binaries than it is to do, say, Forex, CFDs?
A new person coming into, there are various demographic factors that come into it. Which part of the world am I talking to? Is it the US or is it an emerging economy? Because, you know, in emerging economies, typically it's been buy and hold equities. But in other countries, I mean, options is absolutely massive in the US. Why hasn't binary options taken off in the US? It's a question that's asked all the time. So
I think it's a regulatory issue. You can't trade binaries unless they're on exchange. Otherwise, it's illegal. So I think that's a regulatory issue. But I'm just wondering whether, you know, I'm just trying to hark back to this Uberization of finance, whether effectively it's about simplification. For the average person to adopt financial products, they basically do not need to understand it to use it. That's the killer app. If I can just sit at home, switch on an app, and it does just picks up a risk profile and works away in the background, and at least hedges the risk of me losing money with holding money in the bank, that's already doing me a service. And I think the reason I think binary possibly has some traction is because, yeah, it's a gaming product to all intents and purposes, but people can just sit there and trade it because they understand there's some interactivity between it. But CFD, you have no idea what your exposure is, what's going to happen. You just lose on the margin, and then you're out.
Malik, do you want to join the conversation? I saw you.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, as a technology provider, we also looked into binary options for our clients. A lot of people tend to ask for it. We added the product, but we did find that the client base that uses our product didn't find much of a value in binary products at all. They just thought it was gamification. Most of the higher level institutional partners didn't even want that particular product to be visible in their systems. And I think it does go down to the fact that, yes, it's an easy product. Yes, you only have to press two buttons. Well, generally, you only have two buttons in FX as well. Mm-hmm. But the problem comes in that you don't understand how dangerous it is. You don't know the risks in there. Generally, you would find yourself, say you buy a binary options, you're going to lose 100% of it. But when you do make, you do get your return back, but it's almost 60, 80%. So the risk factor is quite high. It's just the way it looks. It makes you feel that it's a lot of easier product than it really is. It's actually quite a sophisticated product and hard to use as well.
And do you think brokers can actually convert somebody that starts, you know, because they want to bet $50 on gold, can they convert him to a $50,000 trader that would stay for years?
Generally, no. What we find our clients to do is they go for clients where they're looking for long-term relationship. They don't want a churn and burn sort of action going on in their brokerage. And they're looking to bring value, as I said, by education. It's very, very important. But more importantly, these guys are looking for products which have value over time. So time factor is very important here. I can buy shares in Barclays for, say, 2 years and sit on them, and I don't have to worry about them. Yes, of course, if the market's going down, they're going to lose value, but not 100% of it. I don't think Barclays is going to go to zero tomorrow or in the next 60 minutes, which is quite important here.
Sure, the guys holding Lehman's are saying the same thing.
Well, that was a bad decision.
I think it depends on really who the client is. I mean, that's really, you know, some people are long-term value investors, and they look at 5 and 10 years, and their profile will take an enormous amount of analysis to make a trading decision. And when they do, they're going to stick with it for a long period of time. On the other side, you might have somebody that's just quick. They want a quick little move in the market and make as much money as possible. So I think it really depends on who you're looking at. And the nice thing about, like all things, there are, you know, there's Skodas and there's Ferraris. You know, not every car fits every person. You know, we're not all driving one type of car. And same with investing. There's a lot of different types of instruments out there because there's a lot of different profiles out there.
Justin, you wanted to.
Yeah, a couple of points I just wanted to comment on. You know, the risk associated,
of course,
aspect of it. You know, you could kind of argue the other side of the coin, where at least with the binary, there is fixed risk associated with it. There's going to be the fixed risk and the fixed gain, right? So yes, it could be 100% of your bet or whatever you want to call it, but it's still known. Whereas other products are going to be an unknown situation. The other point I was going to raise is that binaries initially came out as longer-term products, and as the product evolved, there was pressure from the actual users to continually press down this time to expiration, and that, you know, kind of fed off itself. And now the shorter term the binary, the better. So, you know, on the one hand, you have a simple instrument that has a fixed risk associated with it on the binary side. And then on the other end of the spectrum, you have kind of an overly complicated product in a pure vanilla option. In the middle is some sweet spot, I think, for somebody to create a product that has the same sort of attraction of a fixed risk, the same sort of simplicity as a binary, and do it in a way that doesn't get too complicated like a regular option. So that's actually one of the things that we're working on right now.
So before we wrap up this conversation, does anyone in the audience have any question? Just raise your hand and we'll get you a microphone. Okay. So, yes.
Hello. Hi. I was wondering if I'm... You guys were talking a lot about the binary options. So I'm a startup company on the foreign exchange. So should I or should I not invest on the binary options? Thank you.
I would, first of all, the first thing you need to do is look at which region that you're actually going to offer that to.
Indonesia.
Okay. So the binary market is, in some ways, it's still relatively new. And what you need to do is do some background research to see if anybody else has actually offered that product within that region. One of the easiest ways to actually do it is to actually put out a survey on investment sites to see if anybody would be interested in that type of product. And judging from that, then you make a sensible decision to say, is it worth me investing there? You might want to be doing binary, but maybe not in that region. You might want to do it in another region, but you've also got to see if it's overcrowded as well. So just really simple business analysis would help you.
I would say the simple answer is yes, if you do it under the right circumstances. So, you know, there's a mentality out there when you do something new, fail fast. I would add something to it and say fail cheap. So if you can enter the market with a low cost of entry, keep your fixed variable, or keep your cost variable, and you can find out real quick if this is a viable product or not, you can be out of there without taking too much pain.
Also, there's a regulatory aspect to it. Or you need to check on what the regulations are within Indonesia with respect to binaries. And you know, I think the OTC binary market evolved because to a certain extent it was a gray area. Certain countries couldn't define whether it was gambling or financial services. I mean, it's interesting, you know, in the EU, which has a harmonized financial services industry, it was only CICIC, which were the first jurisdiction with Cyprus, to define binaries as a financial instrument under MiFID, which is the regulations for the whole of Europe. Malta followed with that. Whereas in the UK, for instance, binaries were gambling, and they were regulated.
That's changed, though, right?
Yeah, that's what I mean. So, you know, it's a fragmented market, and you have to understand locally what the situation is. Yes, with the UK, was regulated by the Gambling Commission, and it's only this year that it's shifting over to the FCA. So, you know, for example, in Indonesia, you go in, and actually there are no regulations surrounding binary. Then you're in a gray market. What you want to do is situate yourself in a jurisdiction where there's clarity on what it is, whether that's a tech vehicle or SCA one or something in Singapore.
Any other questions?
So one of those last points you made, what is it you're actually trying to innovate that is low risk and high return?
I'm sorry, can you repeat a bit louder?
What is it you're trying to actually create that is low risk and high return? You say you're working on that now.
Oh, that's directed to me? Okay, so right, on the one end you have a binary option. It's gonna be shorter term, fixed risk. The problem is the payout is either 0 or 100. On the other end, you have an option, single option, that could have, you know, an infinite array of values. Somewhere in that middle ground, there exists, a structure of options that is also going to have fixed risk associated with it, but it isn't going to carry the 0 or 100 kind of yes or no outcome to it. And I think that's going to be an interesting product.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so I think we had a very interesting conversation so far. Do we have time for another question, or? Okay, so yeah, one last comment, wrapping up. Simple question, branding-wise, because we see here in Asia, a lot of people, you know, classify themselves as, bullion company, you know, focusing on gold, but they offer full range. Same thing as, Bitcoin. We said there's specific Bitcoin trading brokers instead of, offering also Bitcoin. So branding-wise, how do you see diversification playing into a broker's strategy?
Over the years, you've had brokers where they offered one product, it being equities, or you had brokers where it was just options. I mean, that question about branding itself, it's a supermarket mentality. Do we have a company which can offer all products to all people, and how do you market that? Against $1 million question, branding is a completely different area, something I don't really cover. But ultimately, I think what people are looking for, number one, is trust in a company. So your brand should really reflect trust. You have to have transparency. The price that I'm seeing, am I actually going to get the price, or am I going to keep getting requoted? But also, and I hear this mostly in Asia than other parts of the world, I'm making money with your company, how quickly can I get it out? So the branding needs to reflect all of those elements, and I'm sure my fellow speakers will add other elements to that. So branding really, to me, it really comes down to building trust.
Ali?
Well, with our partners, we tend to see that they do want to become a one-stop solution for their clients. And if you have a decent brand, you can build on it. As long as you don't go too far out the spectrum and, I don't know, start breeding horses, because that would be bad for a brokerage company to do. But generally, our clients tend to be very specific. They stay within the financial sector, for example, and they're bringing more and more products, and they're becoming a central hub for their clients. So for that, I think and again, you know, this is not something I specialize in, but we do see that the brand means a lot. It to a regional or global level, there are companies that we see every day. We know them very well. And then you have local brands, which tend to be quite famous only within a specific geographic region. And they're trusted. And they're trusted because people have experienced trading or other businesses with them. And it kind of stands as a point of trust for them. So yes, absolutely. So brands should always be around. And I really hope that companies, as they grow, maintain that brand at the same time as well, because you could grow real quick and you could lose credibility at the same time as well, which could be quite dangerous.
Yeah, I think the branding question is actually a pretty simple problem. A company is going to have some sort of identity to their brand, and if they're looking to add a new product and wondering whether to incorporate it under that brand or not, you just need to think about whether this product as a concept is going to potentially tarnish that brand or potentially improve it. If there's some risk associated with that, it's so easy now to start a new brand. You launch that product under a new brand, see how it goes, and if it doesn't work out well, you know what you're getting there, and you didn't tarnish your good standing brand. If it's something that works out well, bring it under the umbrella. So it's I don't think it's a real difficult choice there, with how easy it is now to start a new brand and build it.
Yeah, I agree with that 100%. You know, even though dealing with the whole full spectrum of fintech businesses, every time someone comes to me, the traditional financial business, and they say, we've got a new idea, how do we get this approved or whatever, how do we bring this to market? First thing I say is, first, new company, new brand. And as you're saying, if it succeeds, then you bring it officially within the umbrella. If it doesn't, then you know, you've isolated the risk financially from your holding co and any detriment that might have on your IP. So yeah, and it is easy. It's so easy. Anyone can set up a brand tomorrow. You know, go 99 designs, they do you a logo in a week. You know, I'm not saying that that's necessarily the route you would deploy, but you know, the startup costs now for brands are very minimal. Just one other point is, you know, as you're moving into new markets to differentiate yourself, you're having to consider so many different elements, and there are a lot of unknowns. You know, like we were talking about the binary options market, it's such a gray market from a regulatory standpoint. You don't know when that risk may crystallize itself. So you have to appreciate the unknowns within that business. And if you're in the unknowns game, then it's best to have that well segregated.
This is about as far away from my sweet spot as you possibly could get. I don't really know too much about branding. I would say from my perception that looking out, there seems to be a high level of commoditization in the marketplace right now. And Adam is absolutely correct. $9.95, you can get a full brand package ready to go out the door. Just because you have different colors doesn't really make you different. And I think that is the most important thing to this particular segment in brand identity, is having something really unique. And I'm not sure anybody has it just yet. I think we've all become very commoditized, and whoever can figure that out will really make a lot of money moving forward.
Thank you very much to all the experts.